So in some church, which will remain nameless, one Sunday a person came in wearing a baseball cap, a young man. And the ushers, as he came in, said to him, "Sir, you must remove your hat." But he didn't. Sat in view. So the ushers spoke to the church wardens, who came and spoke to him and said, "You must remove your hat." But he didn't. So they spoke to the rector. And the rector finally came to him and said, "Sir, you remove your hat. Obviously, you don't understand the customs here. You must be new." The man said, "Well, actually, I've been coming here for a couple of years now, but this is the first time that anybody's spoken to me. This morning I've had the ushers and the church wardens and the rector all speak to me, so wearing a hat's a good thing." Well, obviously that's a made-up story, I guess. Might have happened somewhere. I was having lunch with the clergy this week. The clergy from our community, not the other Anglican clergy, but the interdenominational gathering. And so we were sharing some old stories from our past. And I mentioned how we were talking about when we were ordained and what things were like in those days. And I shared what Bishop Arthur Brown told me about when he was going through university, theological college. At that time, and now Arthur Brown he's now passed to heaven, but at that time he was, I think, probably 20 years older than I am. And he said that when he was in theological college, in order for a student to get married, they needed the permission of the principal. And when he was ordained, if he sought to get married, he would need the permission of his bishop. And when he told me that, it was many years ago, I was just aghast to think that would never work in my generation. I mean, I grew up in the 60s and 70s, maybe the hippie movement, so that would not have worked for us to have someone tell us when we could marry or when we could not marry. So the other clergy shared with me the rules and regulations in their church with respect to ordination. So this is not somebody who's now dead. We're talking 15 or 20 years ago. One denomination, the day they were ordained, later that day, they found out where they would be serving tomorrow, where they would begin their ministry. They didn't know till after they were ordained where they would be working. And then every 3 years or so in that denomination, the clergy would find out that they were moving. And they would get a notice that said, "You will be moving. Start packing." And a week later, they would be told where they were moving to. And I thought, that's just bizarre. What is that? Is it some kind of... And then I thought, well, it's not much different than the thing with the hat. It's where we have our own rules and regulations of how we think things should be, and we feel a need to impose them on someone else. Maybe that's to keep people in control or in some kind of servitude, I'm not sure. But there is this tendency in any established thing to make everybody else conform. Any newcomer's got to be like all the old folks. Got to make them do what we do. And I believe that's exactly the thing that Jesus was talking about in our gospel reading today. He said, don't do what they do. Don't do what they do. They bind heavy burdens on people and make them do things that they themselves wouldn't want to do. The reality is that we as Christians have a responsibility not to make people's lives more difficult, but to make people's lives easier. Our challenge is to make other people desire to enter into the Christian faith because it brings so much lightness of spirit, so much joy. It's not a burden, it's a joy. Jesus said, "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." In our reading today from Paul's letter to the Thessalonians, Paul talks about what it was like when I was with you. I didn't let you bear any of my burdens. I came to you and looked after myself. You got a job. part-time job working somewhere in town so that he could then spend his efforts on preaching to the people without them feeling like it was any burden to them. I encouraged you. I comforted you. And his challenge that he presented to himself was to bring light and life to the people. And that's really what the gospel is about. I mean, what did Jesus do when he came? When he began his ministry, he started to preach good news to those who were in need. Not bad news, but good news. He preached good news. He healed those who were sick. And sometimes he got into trouble for that. When he healed someone on the Sabbath day, the religious leaders all pointed fingers at him and said, "You can't do that on the Sabbath day. You're not allowed to work on the Sabbath day." And he said, "Well, if you had an ox or a donkey that falls into a pit on the Sabbath day, certainly you would haul it out. And that would be work, of course. So why can't the human one heal on the Sabbath day?" So Jesus was always bringing good news and good things to people to make their life easier. And he wanted his disciples to do the same. Go into the world and preach this good news and help people to be free from their sins. There have been times in my ministry when people have come to me for confession. Not often, Anglicans don't rush to their priest for confession. We have a saying, you know, that goes, "All may, none must, some should," when you're dealing with confession. And that ministry of reconciliation isn't about someone coming and saying, "Oh, I'm really sorry that I sinned," and then the priest says, "You know, you shouldn't have done that." No, not at all. It's about helping people feel free, finally, from their sins. I've had people come and confess a lifetime of sin. Like, never confessed to anybody before, and they have things that have been burning them for 25, 30, 40 years, and they want freedom from that. And that's the gospel that's been given to us. And it's not just the gospel that's been given to clergy. It's the gospel that's been given to every Christian. To let people be free from their sin. To know that God forgives them. That God's not saying, "Okay, you've been bad and you're going to hell." That's not what God wants to say to people. What God wants to say is, "I came as Christ and offered my life on the cross for you. You don't need to carry this burden anymore. You don't need to be afraid in the dark anymore that God's going to get you. You are free from your sin." And that's why Jesus came and died for us. That's the offering that he made. And he calls us, as the disciples of Christ, to carry out that same ministry. Now, we mustn't forget that Jesus also said, "If you would be my disciple, you must take up your cross and follow me." And he was talking about his cross of suffering that he carried to Calvary upon which he died. So Jesus was saying to us that we must be prepared to suffer. We don't suffer in order to get into the kingdom of heaven. We don't suffer because we've been bad. We don't endure privation and hardship because it's good for our soul. We do that because it brings blessing to somebody else. And when you read more of the letters of Paul, and certainly the Acts of the Apostles, when you find out about all the difficulties and hardships and sufferings that the early apostles went through, they did so to bring grace and peace and love to others. St. Simon, whom we know almost nothing about, after whom this church is named, so the legend is, was sawn in half. And you'll see his stained glass window, which is the first one after the corner there. There he stands with a saw in his hand, carrying the emblem of his martyrdom. And often saints are depicted with the emblem of their martyrdom. They carry it proudly in our depictions, because they were willing to to lay down their lives that others might be free. And that's what the gospel is about. As I've said before, if you share somebody else's burden, their burden is halved. If you share somebody else's joy, their joy is doubled. It's an odd kind of math, but I believe it works. But here, I think, is the key. When you want to share someone else's burden, you don't say, oh, all right, let me do it, I'll help. Because that doesn't do anything for anybody except make them feel no fault about them. If you say, here, let me help you. It would be my pleasure to assist you. You bring joy to the situation. So instead of them now carrying a heavy burden all by themselves, they're carrying half the burden and all of your joy. And so their burden is halved and your joy is doubled. That's the gift that God calls us to give to the world. Come and share the gospel. To bring the light and the peace that God seeks to give to the world into other people's lives. And we do that not by saying to people, you're bad and you've got to change your ways and conform, but to say, look what Christ has done to us to make us free. Lifting us from all the burdens that weigh us down. The sorrow and guilt of the sins of the past. The pain and suffering that others have inflicted upon us, all of those things Jesus washes away and brings us new life and new hope. That's the gift we've been given. And that's the gift that God gives to us to give to others with joy.